To guide you through the rest of the Dick Cavett story is a longtime friend of the museum's. He is the entertainment reporter and critic for WGN Television and WGN Radio, Dean Richards. Dean?
So thank you and good evening, everyone. It's good to be here. So when they were, this is about the most flattering shot of me there could possibly be. We have a cold front coming in over Wisconsin. I wish Tom Skilling was here right now so he could analyze my head. Wow. It is what it is. So when they were deciding, who should sit and talk with one of the legends in television, one of the great pioneers in talk television, you know, they thought and they thought and they thought, and finally it came to them, get me the guy from the Victory Auto Wreckers commercial. And here I am for you. Thank you. Oh, thanks. Thanks. That old car may be worth money. A classic from about 25 years ago for me. I jumped at the chance when I heard that Dick Cavett was going to be honored here at the museum because I have been a fan as long as I can remember. Growing up on the South Side and coming home from school, coming home from work, my appointment television every night was to watch the great Dick Cavett, to see what was going to happen. I mean, it sort of was the original reality television. You really did not know what was going to happen on that show or what amazing guests that he would have on. Or mostly, I think what attracted me was his intelligence and his wit that I've been able to experience a little bit over the past month or so when he's visited on my WGN radio show, and we've had just the best conversations. And then yesterday morning, he was on WGN TV Morning News. That was a little bit like being in a Fellini movie with Dick there and Las Vegas legend Wayne Newton on the show and Dr. Demento on the show. Just another day on the WGN Morning News where you never know who's going to be there and what's going to happen. But Dick was fantastic. I want to get right to the conversation, so we will get right to the tape as tonight the Museum of Broadcast Communications salutes the great Dick Cavett. Take a look.
The Dick Cavett Show. Tonight, Dick's guests are
Marlon Brando,
George Harrison,
Groucho Marx,
Kirk Douglas, John Lennon, Paul Simon, Gloria Swanson, Orson Welles, Betty Davis, Jimi Hendrix Experience. Ladies and gentlemen, Dick Cavett.
You really have been through some incredible things in your career. I mean, the violence of the things you've been through in the films. Have you ever been badly hurt?
Yes, I've been hurt several times. I broke my nose in a picture, I broke a finger, and I broke a rib. You know, it's strange because when I started my career, you're studying Shakespeare and Ibsen, and then you start doing movies, and then suddenly you have to learn how to mount horses and juggle and skip rope and fight, suddenly all that Shakespeare training, you wonder whatever happened to that. And I actually think that in theater, acting, movie making, in your field, I really think that vitality, energy, is the first requirement, because if you don't have vitality and energy, you can't do anything else.
You know, I was browsing through your biography last night, and I had read it a couple of years back, and the idea that when you got out to Hollywood and they thought you were not glamorous seems so stunning to me now, and I guess to everybody.
Well, but I never really did come into that category, you know. for which I'm grateful.
But there was a time there where they didn't even seem to think.
Well, you must remember, I went, you know, in 1930, mm-hmm. when every motion picture actress was really and truly, personally, the most beautiful thing. You know, Jean Harlow and all those beautiful, glamorous people. Mm-hmm. And theater people never thought much about how they looked off stage. Something we had to learn through the years in Hollywood, at least look presentable. But I never had that problem of yeah. glamour, which is perfectly obvious as you sit here and look at me, sir.
You're probably thinking the same about me.
I wanted to digress just for a second there. I have a great deal of sympathy for the fact that you try to put on shows that deal with serious issues. And there's a terrible conflict that you must have trying to make the show entertaining. You have to do that in order to keep that segment of the audience who's not particularly interested in the issues tuned into the station. And I think you do a yeoman's job. There's nobody else on television that does what you do. And very often...
I had pigeons in the room. Did I ever tell you that?
No, pigeons? I'm sure I'd have remembered.
Well, this room had French doors that opened this way.
Yeah.
And it was around the seventh floor, I think. And the pigeons kept flying into the room. Mm-hmm. You know, like they do in New York on windowsills. I don't know if they do it here anymore like they used to. And I was trying to make love to this girl, and a pigeon was biting my ear. I thought it was her. And I was encouraged by this, but...
Even in Hollywood, you can stay married 42 years. You'd be surprised, the people that stay married a long time, but you don't hear about those.
That's true.
See, that's not news, you see. Well, we were married, and we were married in Waukegan, Illinois. I was in a show in Chicago then, in my hometown, Waukegan. And we were married in a friend of mine's single apartment. A very dear friend of mine. And as soon, we were married by a rabbi. And as soon as the rabbi said, I now pronounce you man and wife, Mary fainted right away. She really fell right over on the bed. Imagine. That, if you'll pardon me, that was a little sooner than I expected.
And I discovered one day that I could say I am greater than the universe, lesser than the universe, and equal to the universe. And these are the proofs. I'm greater than the universe because I can think about it and contain it within my head.
Okay.
That's the universe. It's in here. I'm lesser than it because that's obvious. And I'm equal to it because all of the atoms in me are the atoms that make up the universe, the same atoms identically. So, there I am. And what is to fear?
What's the punchline, George?
You got it. It's a long punchline.
You like being over here, I gather. I have had some English guests on. What do you think of yourself as English, first of all? Let's establish that.
Well, sometimes. I mean, if you ask, talking about being over here or being over there, then I think, well, I'm from over there, you know.
Yeah.
But I normally think in terms of I suppose I think in cliques and things like other people, like musicians and or long hairs and or under 30, over 30, etc., etc. And being married to a Hawaiian, it makes you sort of more international. You know?
When were you born?
1900. Yeah, so 12 o'clock at night.
It is. At 12 at night?
Yeah, they called me.
So how did they know whether your birthday was on the... your birthday's on the... I thought it was on the
floor. Well, I didn't ask Mama all that. I was just glad to be here. And I didn't... I wouldn't interfere with her business. You know?
Facts are that the fellow who was Deep Throat, if there was one, had to be probably a member of the FBI.
You probably have a fairly good hunch who that was.
I do. I have my own theory, but I don't believe in making allegations unless I have proof, and I don't have that.
Because as a kid, I was always told Catholics are not allowed to read the King James Version. Is that an old myth that is no longer true?
No, it's not an old myth. It's true that during the religious wars and during the Reformation and Counter-Reformation, nobody was allowed to read the other person's Bible because they didn't trust the theological scruples of the translators.
Yeah.
It was sort of an idea of contamination.
When I thought your career was at the absolute peak, you said, "I'm still knocking at the door." With Annie Hall widely accepted now, can you in 30 seconds admit that you are in danger now of total mass acceptance universally?
I think two things. I think one is I'm making progress toward it, but let's not exaggerate the success of Annie Hall. More than my other films, but nothing when you talk about films like The Deep or Jaws or, I mean, nothing, well, that's even beyond it. Also, I'm going to try and make decisions to keep myself from acceptance by the masses. I'm going to try and do a very serious, dramatic movie next and not be in it with no jokes and try and make all those decisions counterproductive to my best interests.
Well.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the great Dick Cavett.
Have a seat, my friend.
Thank you.
By the way, how's the sound? Okay, can you hear anything? Yeah. Something. Hi, this is Bob. Join the Peace Corps Hope. Okay, that's on my voice warm up.
What do you think of when you see all those old clips?
I didn't watch those.
You were enjoying your dessert at the moment.
I can't bear to see myself for more than 2 hours at a time. A lot of shows I did, I never saw. I would be out that night doing something, and I thought, I'll see it later, and I still haven't. But my friend Robert Bader, who has put a lot of my stuff together, and see, I think before he made the DVD boxed sets of the Dick Cavett Show, he said he watched something nearly 400 Cavett shows. He hasn't been well since.
He's recovered.
But he knows more answers about my past than I do, and he's over there, so if you need... He could come up here now.
We'll bring him up. If you start to fail up here, we'll bring him up.
Instead. By the way, I know it's obligatory to say I'm glad to be here. Can you also see me in the cheap seats? Yeah. By the way, congratulations for not being among the chickens who were scared off by the rain. And also, you will speak next, but I just... you arranged for a siren.
That's right. We wanted you to feel like you were in New York.
My ABC show had a firehouse across the street. And just as Helen Hayes or someone was saying, "Let me count the ways," would blow in. And people thought we did it as a joke. But anyway, I got off the plane with my wife, Martha, and I thought we were in the wrong town because I didn't realize. They said, "We're in a town called Trump." Can't you hang a curtain over the tea? I'm sorry. We're not on yet, are we?
No, this is a great rehearsal far, though. You had a chance to go around Chicago and see a little bit of the city.
That's true. As a kid, I probably came here 15 times in the summer. starting obviously at an early age, I had an uncle in Evanston, and we would drive across in ghastly heat in a 38 DeSoto with, you know, I had to have the windows open, no air conditioning, boys and girls in those days. And it was murder, and they drove across Iowa, which had the highest death rate of any state, truly, from head-on collisions in the heat, and farmers would pull out and burn. I could always count on at least five blood and brains all over the highway, ghastly accidents on our trip to Chicago. And then the first time I got here, I was in hog heaven. My town had a five-story building, and there were the, and somebody said, when you go to Chicago, kid, you're gonna see skyscrapers. And I pictured a machine that scraped the clouds out of the sky. I didn't know what they were talking about for skyscrapers. But here you had magic shops, and I haunted those. Johnny Carson and I were kid magicians, but not simultaneously. And I just, I couldn't wait to get to Chicago every year. And then later, Chris Porterfield is here, and I were here with the book Cavett was on its book tour. Mm-hmm. You know, what fun those are. And I ate at the Pump Room, and we got a dish of oysters that were dried up and looked like they had sat out all night. And I was interviewed the next day, and I said they should call that place the Stomach Pump Room. This appeared in almost every paper in Chicago. I'm surprised I'm back. But now that the town is called Trump, I feel more.
So early, your early Chicago visits were magic shops? Did you?
Oh, I did other stuff too. Yeah. Shed's Aquarium. Is this building burning down? Yeah. Wouldn't that be funny? Well, Cavett joked.
They're headed to the Pump Room. Somebody just had some oysters just, there.
A shish kebab caught fire. Why don't we just all go to the window and see what's happening? Well, can you hear me at this level? Yeah, I went to Shed's Aquarium. I went to the Museum of Science and Industry. I went to the planetarium, and I saw a color through a telescope that the man said is a color we don't have on Earth. And he wasn't kidding. What else do I remember? Bert Allerton doing his vanishing bird cage at tables at the Pump Room and stuff. I liked everything about Chicago. The Sherman, I walked downstairs and there was what's-his-name's show, Welcome Travelers. Tommy something. Yes, thank you.
Tommy Bartlett.
Yeah. But the part that killed me, although they had John Carradine there that day as a guest, the host said, hey, we had Bob and Bing here both together yesterday. I thought, there is no God. I could have been here yesterday too. But I can think of nothing bad about Chicago, except the late Mayor Daley and a few others. Oh, there went half the audience.
I think half the audience may not remember the original Mayor Daley. I don't know.
Oh, well, the older folks tell the young folks who people are.
So how did the path take you from Nebraska to writing for Jack Parr and writing for Johnny Carson and some of your working on Time magazine?
Well, it's a path that has some critical coincidence in it. But a friend of my parents had a fellowship to Yale, a fellow school teacher. My father taught school for $900 a year in the Depression and always told me about that. I couldn't believe it. But anyway, this fellow teacher went to Yale for a year, and it happened to be the year I was going to graduate the next year. And he said, Dick should apply to Yale. And I thought, I don't even know where Yale is. And I did. And he said, here's another point. Don't let him apply to any place else. Somehow, at that time, maybe bad advice today, I don't know, or maybe in what they called regional distribution, they threw a dart at a dartboard and hit Lincoln, Nebraska and got me. I got that letter, I knew what would be inside it, and I thought my parents will be so disappointed, and it said, congratulations, you'll be a member of the class. I thought, what does this mean? I leave Lincoln? They weren't gonna bring Yale to Lincoln. And I did go there. There I immersed myself in theater, sneaking into Jackie Gleason's show and television shows in New York, accosted every star I could meet.
How did you sneak into Gleason's show?
Made,
Huh? How did you sneak into Gleason's show?
Ah, good question, Mr. Holmes. I got a CBS envelope. It was about this big, mailer envelope with a big CBS eye. And in my ballsy or brass way, brash I mean, I would, unconscious joke, I would go in the stage door of the theater, which is now the Ed Sullivan, and they'd say, yeah. And I'd say, how's it going today? And they'd say, oh, you know, the usual. And I would be sure they could see my CBS envelope. And I would march right on in. Nobody ever stopped me.
Act like you know where you're going. Act like you know what you're doing.
Say again?
Act like you know where you're going.
Oh, yeah, that's another thing.
Yeah.
If you're going into a place and you're not supposed to be there, you'll walk sort of like this. But you can't do that. You gotta come like walk like this. Well, that's a guy who knows this place,
yeah.
And that works. Don't all try it at once. But from that, there's the oftentimes and too often told story of how get this coincidence that might have determined that we would not be here tonight. I'm a copy boy at time, out of work actor, in my teens, I guess. Just out of college. And one year out, somebody at the copy desk, where all of us who made $60 a week would gather, someone left a Journal American paper open, and it said Jack Parr worries more about his monologue than anything else in his life. Someone happened to leave that paper open to that page, and I happened to see Jack's name in heavy type. And I thought, I'll go home and try writing a Jack Parr monologue, because I never missed his show. Many of you know the rest of the story, but I took it the subway down to the RCA building, which I had scoped many times. No security in those days. Knew the Sixth Avenue elevators would drop you off at Jack's floor, and as incredible luck would have it, here came Jack coming along the corridor from the men's room. I let him see my Time magazine envelope, and I said, I have some material for you, Mr. Parr. He said, oh, okay, that's what I need. I got a horrible cold, excuse me. But I went and sat in the audience. Jack came up, and he reached into his pocket and took out folded papers, and I thought, I made. But it was a routine about parking. And I felt awful. That was the day of the pirate, first of the hijacked ships, way back then. Pirate ship, it said in papers. Oh, he went out in the audience, Jack, and a woman said, hey, Jack, what do you think about that pirate ship? And he said, can you imagine the passengers hearing a voice saying, attention, please, this is your pirate speaking. Don't you see? And it got a huge laugh there. And don't feel bad. And that was one of the lines I'd given him. And then he did two or three more. I contrived, not being stupid, to be in the elevator with him as he went down later. And he said, you want to write, don't you, kid? And that's how I got to be. That's good. It's kind of a long story. Anyone want to hear it again?
So was it from that then that you transitioned when Parr left The Tonight Show, that you transitioned when Johnny Carson took over? And
yeah, but not immediately. Those of us at the right age may recall that to Johnny's great advantage, he didn't take over for Jack the next week. There was a whole summer of Tonight Show to fill. Contract-wise, he couldn't go in right away, and he was wise enough not to have Jack leave on Friday and people crying and come on unwelcome on Monday. So in that summer, I wrote for Mort Saul, Groucho Marx, Stephen Eady, Jackie Leonard, one of the Gabors. I was going to say the boring one, but how would you know? And almost anyone you ever heard of.
We have a table of Zsa Zsa fans over here, I think.
Oh, Zsa Zsa, darling, I don't mean you. But yeah, if you want to write for anybody who can kill a joke, write for Art Linkletter. Just a minute, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, how was that?
Well, I can't help it, don't blame me. You really want a proof?
Give me an example, what do you mean?
He spelled it out, as we say. The brilliant David Lloyd wrote a line, we're honoring comedy teams tonight, Art was supposed to say. You know, comedy teams, Laurel and Hardy, Smith and Dale, Abbott and Costello, and Jackie Leonard. Jack was large, for those who don't know. Here, Art Linkletter, making sure that you and I would get it. Tonight, we're honoring comedy teams, Laurel and Hardy, Martin and Lewis, none of them, and big fat Jackie Leonard. Now, just in case, who's so fat that he's a one-man comedy team all by himself.
Wow. Wow.
I went downstairs and bought a Bennett Cerf joke book, and we copied jokes for the rest of the week and gave them to Art. We donated ourselves to Art.
What was it like writing for Carson in those early years?
Carson was easy to write for. A great Bob Hope writer told me that the key to writing for comedians is famous ones, is that you've seen them, you've heard them, and you can hear them in your head. You can turn them on. You wrote the joke slightly differently for Jack than you would for Johnny, certainly differently than you would from Jack Benny, and from that different the way you'd write it for Bob Hope. I took Groucho a line once, and I learned a little something about rhythm. He said, that's a very good joke, eh? But it needs a sightney. I said, what? It needs a sightney. You could have fooled me, but it should say, yes, sightney could have fooled me. And that rhythm made the line. I also gave him a line I thought would go nowhere, which was, still thrilled to be writing for him. I said, end of monologue, say, but enough of this bridal hilarity. That too killed them. Now, I'm gonna do it again. Anyway.
You also wrote for Jerry Lewis, and I'm fascinated to find out what that was like. Because I've had a few experiences with Jerry Lewis, and they've always been more than interesting. I can only imagine during his heyday what it might have been like for you.
Well, as a kid, of course, I loved Martin Lewis. And Jerry did a show that ABC is still paying for, I think. Some are old enough to have repressed the memory of it. It was 2 hours Saturday night, and they saturated the country with, what's he going to do for 2 hours live? What's he going to do for 2 hours? What's Jerry going to do for 2 hours? Everybody got sick of that. But then the show came on, and they got sick of that quickly. And it's ranked in the humor files next to the Hindenburg. But I want to tell you. And I gave Jerry, he got a big laugh opening night with one joke I gave him. He said, I'm sick of hearing, what am I going to do for 2 hours? Why me? Why do they pick on me? You'll guess from what I'm going to say what time this was contemporary with. Why not Liz and Dick? Nobody asks what they can do for 2 hours. It's funny, they didn't like that one as much as you did.
Can never tell. When did a light go on or something with you that said, I should be the one that's behind the desk. I should be the one doing the jokes and asking the questions.
This is a shrewd question on your part, yeah. It's not inevitable. Not every comedy writer wishes he were the one out there getting the laughs, getting the adulation, signing the autographs, having a home in Beverly Hills and another one in East Hampton. Many comedy writers are very, very happy, as one of them said, to get a big check. When you go into comedy writing, as my great late legendary manager, God, he's not late, he's still alive, manager said, at 99 years old, Jack Rollins. And he said, lad, when you write comedy and succeed, when you do comedy and succeed, money will come down upon you in a golden shower. Jack didn't realize that golden shower has another meaning.
Um,
So both Woody, who was standing there, and I went, yes, Jack. But it's true, and you get paid an awful lot. When I went from $60 a week to, in the early 60s, $360 a week, all I could think was, look at this, and next week they're gonna give me the same amount again? And next week, as maybe as far as the minimum 13 weeks? But there it was, and Johnny and Jack were easy to write for me. I could just switch them on and knew exactly how they'd say it. But the thing I liked most with Johnny was, and we were very good friends, he adored me. It's so strange. He didn't adore many people, certainly not his mother. And people in the trade know about that. But one night on The Tonight Show, I was just starting out, and he had me out first and three other illustrious guests. And I did my thing. It worked. This was in Hollywood. And I moved down. Now I'm down at the bottom with Ed McMahon. No reflection on Ed. I mean, it was called the bottom of the couch. And it was the end. Marlene, what are you doing? Oh, I have a new movie, Johnny. Thank you. Okay, well, thanks for being here. We're almost off. John, what do you do? Somebody else has a book. Somebody else has a new musical they're opening in. And I saw him realize I had nothing. And he tried to fill the last seconds, but he couldn't. And he said, Richard, what's going on with you? And the gods smiled on me, and I heard myself say, Johnny, I'm working on a sitcom. It's a humorous version of Gilligan's Island. And Johnny, you know that take he'd do where he went off the chair and then came back and sat down? That was a golden moment. And a big dumb columnist in New York worded it a comedy version of Gilligan's Island, which, as we can see, is the same joke, but with no finesse. It's a humorous version. Groucho and I were in Lindy's. I still have to pinch myself that I knew Groucho Marx. And a boring columnist whose initials were Leonard Lyons. he was a wonderful man, and I got a nasty letter from his son when I told this story once, and I liked them both. But anyway, he was really a liked man, but he had a terrible penchant for screwing up quotes. He comes up to Groucho. Groucho, say something funny. And Groucho, and I had to move away for a minute, and when I came back, Leonard was going away, writing down, and I said, you said something funny? He said, yeah. And I said, you know he'll screw it up. And Groucho said, I know. The only way to get Leonard to print a joke right is to tell it to him wrong.
You said that Johnny liked you a lot. When you were competing against him, did that friendship sustain? Because he was sort of well known for being, you know, very competitive and would view someone as, you know, as betrayal if they went up against
him. Well, and we saw what happened to Miss Joan Rivers.
Exactly.
And it never occurred to me that would happen to me, but maybe that's naive innocence. But I would call him and ask him for advice, and he'd say, Richard, it'll wear you down. And it did, you know. 90 minutes, 5 days a week. That took real men to do talk shows in those days, I said to a reporter. And the story came out, Cavett slams Colbert and Stewart. So I called them up, and they were furious. But isn't that stupid? But yeah, and I did two 90-minute shows on Friday night in order to have a three-day weekend. But by the end, 20 minutes before the end of the second 90-minute show, I didn't know who I was, who the guest was, what I was doing. It's true, I used to be a tall, red-headed man.
It literally wore you down. It
wore me right
literally.
Down.
I want to talk.
Conan O'Brien's only this tall.
I want to talk more about those shows, but we have some folks here tonight who would like to say hello and have some greetings for you. And one you referred to a few moments ago, Christopher Porterfield. What, yes. Why don't you explain your relationship with him?
I will do that. Would this be my last time up here tonight to tell a favorite story that's not very long?
We're going to be here till 2, 3 in the morning.
Audiences seem to adore it. So, Chris, you can go back to New York. And no, this won't take long. Yeah, Chris Porterfield and I met at Yale freshman year, and we have been friends ever since. Or did we take a year off? Ever since. I got to tell you this because I think it's a delightful, lovely, innocent, beautiful show business story. Working on The Tonight Show, Hog Heaven again, I could hang out with all my heroes that I never expected to meet, that I would lie on my back in Lincoln, Nebraska and watch on our black and white set. Everybody, Gleason, Jack Benny, Milton Berle, Cosby, of course, came along later. But Bob Hope knew me when he saw me. I go, hey, my man, how are you? And I thought, God, he knows my name. And he came to Lincoln once, and as he finished his show and came down some steps, I said, as a little boy, fine show, Bob. And he said, hey, thanks, son. Decades later, he came on my show, and I told him that. And he said, was that you? Anyway, here's the story. I didn't make that. Jack Benny, I always hung around him. I loved him. And I would go into the makeup room and chat with him there. Oh, that's good booze. Jackie Gleason. And I'd ask him if he was nervous, however, and he said, I got less nervous. Mary got more nervous. Well, that particular night, The Tonight Show ended, and Jack was leaving, and I got in the elevator with him, getting every bit I could. And mistakenly, about 8 tourists got in, too. They were supposed to not use that elevator. Now, a certain age you have to be to get the following references. The first bore says, do you really play the violin? Another one says, by the 6th floor, do you not really pay Rochester? And do you, Mr. Benny, do you still drive the Maxwell? And you could see him, because he was such a lovely man, only person I can think of in show business that everybody loved, and the cleanest working comedian in the history of radio. Hope was always in trouble. By the 2nd floor down, where it was probably, do you still have a guy in a vault under your house guarding your money, you know? Well, they all rushed out of the elevator to tell their friends. And I said, Mr. Benny, after so many years, don't those people get a little tiring? And he's a nice man, put his hand on my shoulder, and he said, you know, kid, sometimes you just want to tell them to go fuck themselves. You can use that in your nightclub. Oh, there's somebody leaving. Never heard the word kid before. Okay.
Christopher Porterfield.
Christopher Porterfield is smarter than I am, but he denies this. He's from Edina, Minnesota. He's not bad looking. We met a freshman year, and we were roommates at Yale for quite a while. He put up with sharing a room with me and two other guys. At that time at Yale, rooms made for two had 4 in them. And then he's been my producer, and then he was at Time Magazine in various levels up to as high as you could go without becoming successor to the late Henry Grunewald, executive editor of Time, a very accomplished gent. And we did 2 books together. The book Cavett was written in dialogue form. And we suffered a book tour together. I was asking Bruce, was it here or Detroit, where I went on without warning with a guy whose fun was treating celebrities shabbily. And I had jet lag. And I took one insult after another. And finally, I kind of woke up and I said, Jim, or whatever his name was, can I ask you a question? You make decent money on this show? He said, yeah. Can't you afford a rug that doesn't look like half a coconut sitting on top of your head? That's the side of me you hadn't suspected. Anyway, Chris Porterfield.
Oh, we don't have time for him anymore, unfortunately.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Christopher Porterfield, there, please come up. And please come up and say hello.
Do I go somewhere?
No, we'll stay here. Oh, we'll stay here.
A hearty hand clasp. Don't tell everything.
Spill it.
Thank you, Dean. And Dick. When I first met Dick, can it really have been 60 years ago?
A lie.
It takes my breath away to say that.
Nothing in anyone's life is 60 years ago.
Most of you probably weren't even born then. When I first met Dick, I could tell right away how original and special his mind was. He said something ambiguous that could have been interpreted as meaning A or B. I asked him which he meant. He said, which is funnier? That touches the essence of Dick Cavett. Another thing that struck me was it had an uncanny ability to do instant anagrams. All he had to do was look at a theater marquee with the name Alec Guinness on it to know that it was an anagram for genuine class. He didn't stop to think about it. It just came to him in a process that he once described to me as, and I'm quoting, a high-speed brain-tongue connection with no sense of control or choice on my part. And I'll come back to that in a minute. Dick and I shared a passion for language and literature, and he taught me to share his passion for show business. In our Yale days, he led many an expedition to New Haven's Schubert Theater, where we saw Broadway tryouts for everything from O'Neill to Tennessee Williams to the first public performance of My Fair Lady. And when we went, he always knew how to wangle his way backstage. We went to the actors' dressing rooms while I stood there tongue-tied. He knew even then how to play to their interests, how to amuse them and draw them out. After graduation, as he mentioned, Dick's first job was as a writer for Jack Parr on The Tonight Show. A few years later, when he landed his own talk show, a morning show on CBS, it was Parr who gave him a piece of advice that I think is a key to Dick's career. Kid, he said, don't do interviews. Make it a conversation. Yeah. If you think about the hundreds, the thousands of fascinating and entertaining shows that Dick has done over the years, they're conversations. Free-flowing, unpredictable, lively, sometimes surprisingly revealing. I was involved with the Cavett Show during most of the 1970s. Dick and I had always thought it would be fun to work together with me as his producer. We were wrong, of course. Not that it wasn't interesting and sometimes rewarding, but fun isn't quite the word. The thing we failed to take into account is that by definition, the producer is pitted against the least attractive traits of the star. His privilege to be late, to change his mind, to be capricious about booking decisions, or about almost anything else. Our deal was, if it ever came to a conflict between the job and the show, the job would go. in other words, my job. We had some close calls, but our friendship and my job survived. In fact, I emerged from those years with my admiration for Dick's talents not only intact, but magnified. I truly believe he was born to be on live television. He thrives on everything about it. Its liveness, its quickness, its danger, and spontaneity. Of course, spontaneity does have its limits. Mm-hmm. By way of illustration, let me give you a piece of advice. If you ever find yourself producing a live national broadcast with Dick as the host, and seconds before airtime, he turns to you and says, "I want to do the opening without cue cards." And nowadays, he'd say, without a teleprompter. "I want to do the opening without cue cards. It'll be more natural and convincing." Don't go there. This is not a hypothetical example. June 2nd, 1977, live from Lincoln Center on the PBS network. Dick did the opening without cue cards, announcing that the evening's performance was the American Ballet Theatre's production of Giselle, starring two legendary Russian dancers, Mikhail Brishnikov and at this point, he blanked on the name Natalia Makarova. If you could watch a tape of the broadcast, you might hear my desperate whisper from off camera, "Natalia Makarova, Natalia Makarova." Somehow Dick finally came up with the name and everything went fine from there on. But in those few moments, I felt like I lost 5 pounds in 2 years off my life. I mention this lapse not to embarrass Dick.
No.
Well, maybe a little. But really, because it was such a rarity, for more than 40 years, Dick has almost invariably been at his best in spontaneous moments, quick and sharp and witty. That high-speed brain-tongue connection that I mentioned has kicked in almost every time. He has been a gift to the medium of television. And even though he's had a brilliant career, I'm not at all sure that the medium has ever made quite enough of that gift. Lately, he's been on the medium less frequently, but he's launched another career by going back to writing. He produces a popular column for the New York Times website. A couple of years ago, these pieces were collected into a book called Talk Show. This fall, another collection will come out titled Brief Encounters. So, in the long run, will Dick turn out to be a TV performer who also had a vivid flair for writing, or a writer all along who made a decades-long detour into performing? Let me ask you, which is funnier?
Right.
Who was that? So, well, but I hold my breath a few times in there.
So of the conversations that you've had on your many shows, are there ones that are most memorable? Which one surprised you most?
That's hard to say, because every time I think of an answer for something like that, I realize, oh, but I forgot about this or that. One thing that's amazing to me is watching the old shows, how much you forget. And I think I came up with an insight about doing that kind of thing thanks to Johnny Carson, who one night, it solidified a thought that I must have had forming in my mind. I was on his show. Whenever a Cavett show went off, Johnny would have me on the following Monday and say, if this next one doesn't work, it's going to be Armed Forces Radio for Richard. but as I say, we were good friends. And one night, Johnny was very tense off camera. And on the air, he was fine. But one night, I was on. He had the band play loud music so he wouldn't have to talk to the guests between breaks, which is not only typical of him, but not a bad idea. And especially if they're loaded or boring. Anyway, get to it, Dick. He said, Richard, you ever forget who you had on? And I said, well, yeah, there have been so many. He said, no, no. I mean that night. And I started to laugh. And I saw that he was concerned and a little bit like that. And he was worried. Now, at that point, Johnny had a wife on the ledge, and he was drinking a good bit. He was a tense man, hardest person to talk easily I've ever met, practically, considering his great career as a talker. And I felt sorry for him, and he went on to say, no, that night, I mean, like, I went home last night, he said, we didn't say like in those days. I went home that night, he said, and last night, and the doorman said, so who do you have on tonight, Mr. Carson? And I said, we had the usual four, and Richard, I couldn't think of any of them. The show was 40 minutes earlier, and he was worried, and I liked him so much, and I wanted to make him feel better, and I thought, oh, good, I'll tell him this. I came home one night from a one-person show, 90 minutes, and I came to the apartment. There was some people there. Somebody said, how did the taping go? I said, fine. They said, who was it? I said, oh, my God. They sat right there. I couldn't come up with it. Now, you'll admit, it's a rather obscure name, Lucille Ball. Across my heart, it was gone. And I realized that night, this idea that had been bubbling, you're not the same person on the air. No matter how yourself you claim to be and appear to be, you're an actor, you're doing a show, you're not doing learned lines, but you're not yourself. You don't, you leave that person there, you go home, and you become, put the mask on and be that person again. And everybody I've talked to about it, absolutely, every actor knows this.
So who is the Dick Cavett that goes home then? Who's the Dick Cavett that we don't know?
I'm not allowed to tell you. That was Alfred Hitchcock, who said to me once, out of the blue, during a commercial break, looking not even at me, band playing, Grace Kelly, the most promiscuous woman I've ever known. Nobody told us.
No.
I just throw that in.
So is the off-air Dick Cavett significantly different than the public Dick Cavett?
I don't know. You know, I've pondered this, but I'm embarrassed not knowing how to answer it. But I seem the same to myself. But so many times I'd come off and they'd say, God, that golf thing you said. And I would say, what golf thing? And they would tell me. And then I vaguely remembered having just said it. But something that Mr. Brando explained to me when I was talking to him about this, if you know what that's called, it's called automatic pilot. You have to have it or you die out there. It takes over for you. During a fit of deep depression, I was able to do a show and I couldn't remember what I had said in the previous sentence. Thought I would not dare watch it. That the guests knew my brain was busted, that I had gone insane. And I told Brando about one particular one with Laurence Olivier. He said, do me a favor, go home and watch it. I looked fine. Brando's automatic pilot was with me, but I couldn't do it at home. I couldn't do it at home. Isn't that interesting?
After the Beatles, broke up, the first interview that John Lennon did with Yoko Ono was with you.
That's right.
On your show. What was that night like?
Well, I loved that night because, though I never gave much of a damn about rock music, they all did my show. Partly because Janis liked it, and she did everybody. Jimi Hendrix thrilled my band, which was full of some of the top flight jazz musicians of the world in that studio band. Let me give you an example of how versatile they were and how quick and how professional. Bob Hope did a surprise appearance. Bobby Rosengarten over here could see Hope coming onto the stage from the wings, saw him, and the timing went like this. Memory and F, thanks for them. And the band came in that second, everybody's instrument. They could do anything. And Chris came in one day, commercial rehearsal, and they said, do you have any idea who you have sitting over there? Milt Hinton, Tommy Kaye, Bucky Pizzarelli. Huge stars. Loved not having to travel. And they, when they watched Jimi Hendrix, Tommy Kaye, a guitar player, they just all watched him rehearse with their mouths open and then said, Tommy Kaye said, he just did things that can't be done on a guitar.
Did Lennon's people contact you?
Oh, Lennon.
We want to come on your show. Did you pursue that?
Somehow they had seen the show. I said, let's ask them to come on. They said, you must come meet them first. So I went to the St. Regis Hotel, went up to their room. They were both on the bed. But they were on the bed. They were had projects working in folders and stuff.
Clothed and on the bed? Clothed on the bed, they're famously naked, the famous photo of that. Oh,
no, nobody's naked. Ever been naked in my life. Well, I take that back. But John was instantly personable, accessible, easy to talk to, as easy as Groucho was to talk to. When you met Groucho, you felt you'd known him all your life, a wonderful, rare quality in a man of probably the greatest wit, along with Fred Allen and Oscar Levant of our time. Groucho leaving a snooty dinner party in Los Angeles. Hostess, leaving so soon, Mr. Marx? I've had a wonderful evening, but this wasn't it. John and Yoko killed two packs of Viceroys in the first three segments, it seemed. Shocking now to see people smoking on the talk shows. And then John baffled many people by doing an imitation of David Frost and not explaining who he was. and why he was doing it. Just to amuse me, because we had spoken of our mutual disinterest in David Frost, to use the wrong word wrongly. But suddenly, if you see that show again, John goes, Dick, what's your definition of love? That was Frosty. The great Calvin Trillin said, the only Englishman who can condescend in a working class accent.
Did you become close?
But he was a dear friend of mine, of course.
Yeah, apparently I can see. Did you become close friends with John Lennon?
I didn't, no. John wrote me a couple of wonderful letters that I've lost. Typed on both sides. Deft, clever, funny, punning, wordplay writer. And we saw each other a couple more times. And that was it until the day that now causes foreign tourists every day in my life that I live there practically, if I go to the corner of 72nd and Central Park West where the deadly deed took place, to say, can you direct us to Strawberry Fields? That was a Swedish person. Und können Sie mir bitte sagen, vielen Dank, is a German person. Kurede, John Rennan, and I get all these languages, and that was the end, and it's just outrageous. What do you expect in a country that has the most insane gun laws of any place in the world? The problem is insoluble. It's over by now. We've had an average of a shooting at a school and that kind of thing once a week since Columbine, and it's just, no other country has it. What does that say? You don't have to answer it.
You said it all, I think, with your statement. But it wasn't it John Lennon that sort of put you on the Richard Nixon hit list, wasn't it?
John Lennon, I used to be persona grata at the Nixon White House. I was even invited to an evening of Shakespeare there. Met the great unindicted co-conspirator in the line, the Yorba Linda wonder, and he said to me, with his gift for light conversation, who's doing your show tonight? And I said, Joe Namath, in fact, was. How are his knees? So I moved on to Mrs. Nixon, whom I adored. One of the most, your heart went out to her, to coin a phrase. And if she had ever written her book, wow. But then I campaigned for Lennon not to be thrown out of Nixon and Haldeman, his lickspittle, Elizabethan term, I think, can be seen on YouTube tonight when you go home if you group Nixon, Cavett, and there you can see a still of Dick and Haldeman in the Oval Office, and the words come up on the screen, and the words from the tapes include Cavett, how can we screw him? And that lovely man who loved to illegally use the IRS to screw people. Couple years after the fact, one of my staff members said to the ever, were you ever audited? And the other lady, maybe a secretary, said, yes, I was audited. Turns out they were audited at the same time. And so was everybody else on my staff. But nobody mentioned it, and so I never knew about it. So the son of the president, managed to screw us, but here we are having the last laugh.
Let's
hear it from the other side now.
In talking with people at the reception here tonight, they, you know, were telling me questions that they wanted to ask, and the question that came up most often was, "Who was your
Favorite guest.
Your favorite guest.
Or your most
exactly
interesting
that
guest.
I know that you've answered a million times.
I've outlawed that question because I can't ever answer it.
Yeah. Is it Groucho? Groucho?
For you, I will make a concession.
Thank you.
I like you.
Thank you.
Lucky thing for you.
It is.
Now, if Groucho said that, it would be hilariously funny. he meant the most to me, finally, I guess. But otherwise, how can you say Brando was better than Orson Welles and Lucy than Robert Mitchum or Fred Astaire or Hitchcock or whoever. You know, there's just, you can win a 100-yard dash, but you can't say who's the winner of best guest or anything like that. But I think I've done my best.
How about the guy that actually died during an interview that you were doing with him?
I have any idea what you're talking about? There's a dirty trick. If there's a Guinness Book of Records with a category, man drops dead while taping a talk show in front of an audience, I am probably the only occupant in that category.
Yeah. Explain what happened.
Well, I wrote a column about this about a year ago in my Times blog. You can still find it. Can't forget the title. Can't remember the title, but it was, it started. Still, even this month, someone has come up to me after all these years and said, I'll never forget the look on your face when that guy died on your show. And I say, oh, you were in the audience? Because it never aired. If we need any further proof that eyewitness testimony is worthless, any magician and anyone who's ever done television can give you plenty of argument that it is worthless. who would the gods have die on a talk show but a health expert? It was in all the papers. It may be news to you. Most people have repressed it, but he was J.I. Rodale of Rodale Press, you know, Prevention Magazine, and lots of health stuff. Someone said it was a tribute that he lived into his 60s or whatever he was then because he had had rheumatic heart. But yeah, he was very funny, half-hour segment, move on, it's the 12:30 slot, bring out the new guest, Pete Hamill, journalist, and Pete and I are talking, Rodale is sitting down there, and he had been so funny that I had made a mental note to have him back. Must tell the staff to have him back, and that old familiar sound. Someone said that upon seeing and hearing that, and Pete Hamill turning to me and saying, this looks bad, and happened to be in close-up, that I said, are we boring you, Mr. Rodale? Hoping he was joking, because he had been funny. And you know, on a talk show, sometimes a comic will snore while his other comic friend is on and say, oh, I'm sorry. But no, Rodale had, to paraphrase the jazz term, purchased the acreage. he was dead on arrival at Roosevelt Hospital, but one doctor told me he was dead then. It was awful, and the audience thought it was part of the show for a measurable amount of time, because why not? It was like, we're here, a stage, lights, audience, band playing, must be part of the show. But I saw two stewardesses in the front row crying, and then the perception that a man had just joined the silent majority, moved out like a wave almost, row by row. Very, very weird. I went over and took hold of his wrist and realized, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know what a wrist is supposed to, but I'm the one in charge. When I went to 244, his 49th, and went into Katharine Hepburn's living room to talk about her, about maybe coming on the show, she sat on the floor with her legs and said, I want to hear everything about the man who died on your show. Because she was a great medical buff, her dad was a doctor, and she always gives pills to people in cast that she worked with. She wanted to hear everything about that. Yeah. I said to her, a strange moment, Miss Hepburn, call me Kate. Kate, I walked to the edge of a stage, I'm told, and I said, is there a doctor in the audience? And I said, why did I hesitate and stop like that? And she said, well, don't you know? You knew if you said, is there a doctor in the house, there would have been a laugh. And she's absolutely right. You know, it was, so that was nice on her part.
Well, let's bring up to the stage somebody who maybe can answer my question, who is the Dick Cavett, the non-public Dick Cavett, and that is Martha Rogers. Explain.
Martha Rogers is here?
So I hear.
Oh, what is this? This is your life? Martha Rogers. Oh, Martha's my wife.
Your wife, exactly.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah. This is awful.
If he only knew. I just want to thank all of you for the chance for us to be here in Chicago. It's really beautiful. And thanks to Bruce and to Wally and to Paul and Dean for doing everything you're doing. And to Eric and to Chris and to Robert for being here. You know, I have to tell you something. The most frequent thing I say when Cavett and I are out on the street is, here, give me the camera, and then you can both be in the picture with him. That's my job. That's really pretty much what I do. But I will tell you this, that you know, there are a lot of people who come up on the street and talk to us, and that's great, that's fine. And about a tenth of them, about one out of 10, comes up and doesn't say anything about television, but says thank you to him for the work that he's done in to make available and really accessible the idea of clinical depression, because of course he's been fighting that for much of his life and has been winning. And basically, it's been, these people come up to him and they say, thank you, because, you know, if it weren't for you, we would have lost my father. Or because he said, if Dick Cavett can deal with this, then I can too. And he got help. Thank you for saving my daughter, my best friend. And they come up and say that to him. And it's really wonderful to watch him as that sort of hero. And so I know that all of you know him as brilliant and witty and intelligent and articulate and all that other stuff, and he certainly is all those things. But I know him as somebody who's a hero. I know him as somebody who's really funny. I get to hear him in the next room singing Gilbert and Sullivan. Aren't you envious of that?
There will be time.
I get to hear the phone conversations in other languages, and I get to hear the Shakespeare soliloquies that seem to pop out of nowhere. And so I'm extremely lucky. But you know, the people who come up to us and say to him, you know, you should be on television. Why aren't you still on television? And the guy who came up to us at the Armory in New York, and we were there to see the American Indian artifacts. This guy comes up to him, he's really angry, walks up to Cavett, he says, hey, you know, why in the world aren't you still on television? It's ridiculous. You know, television these days is just nothing like what it was. We really need you back. And they just yelled at him, just let him have it. And then he turned to me, and he said, and you know, you are so lucky. And I said, I know, I'm the luckiest woman in the world. I know. So it is very funny. So all of you know him as really great and wonderful, and I know him as a few other things, and I want you to all have a great time with him tonight, because I'm the one that gets to take him home after the show.
Could you do that line again about being the luckiest woman in the world?
Some of your friends...
How many believed it?
Some of your friends who could not be here tonight sent taped greetings.
What?
Let's take a look at... why do we keep taking pictures of my bald head? Is there possible that we...
I hope it's Dick Cheney.
...notified me and said they were honoring you in Chicago, and could I send some kind of message? And my message to you is, if I were you, I would get out of Chicago as quickly as possible. I'll see you back in New York, and congratulations.
Hi, I'm Alec Baldwin, and I'm here with my dog, Itana, and my dog, Demita. And we watch the Dick Cavett DVD box set all the time. Itana, what are your favorite interviews that Dick Cavett has on the box set? Or you like the London Fontaine and the Les Dramatics episode you found very, very interesting. Me too, I like that episode too. And Demita, what are your favorites? Bette Davis, John Lennon, and Richard Burton. Interesting. Bette Davis, John Lennon, Richard Burton. In our house, we are unapologetic Dick Cavett junkies. All of us. Congratulations, Dick.
So, I'm glad I didn't have a camera there so he'd hit me.
So two people without any controversy at all, yeah, congratulating.
We are good friends. I am stunned. How on the earth you got Alan to do a minute? That's terrific. And Alec is, by the way, one of the very funniest people in the world. An ex-producer of mine said, who worked with him, privately, which he doesn't show us enough, but you may have seen it on talk shows, he ranks with, and they said, Dick, who are the greatest talkers you've ever had on? Name just maybe three that come to mind. Of course, Orson Welles, Peter Ustinov, and Jonathan Miller from England. Alec is that good, and he can do anybody's voice. He's a good friend, and so is Alan. Yeah. One problem with Woody is we both have lost hearing at various speeds. So one day he said, Cavett, walk on my right side as we were out in the street. And I thought, is this from his religion or something? I didn't know. But I did. And then the next couple years went by and I said, Woody, would you walk on my left side as this year started? A few years ago, I made him laugh for one of the three times in my life, 50 years that I've known him, laugh out loud. when I said, Alan, we've just run out of sides of each other to walk around. Anyone else have one of these? Wait, now I can't hear myself. There it is. But it's a wonder. Deafness is a nice thing when you're with the right people.
Another friend is with us tonight, Eric Metraxas. What is your relationship with Eric Metraxas?
Eric Metaxas.
Metaxas.
And I met when I was the speaker at a Yale, either class day or graduation, years after I had graduated. And he was 10 years or so later, and he did a bit of comedy in this presentation where I sat next to Maria Tallchief. And he and a friend did a thing, and I could see immediately that they, as they say, had it. And Eric is a lot of dull things, highly intelligent, greatly articulate, extremely funny, happily married, wrote that great Bonhoeffer book that, and he's working on one of several books probably right now. You'd be wise to have him up here talking now instead of me. Eric.
Sir.
Oh, wait, me. What about me?
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Oh, we're only good friends. Shoot.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. What an honor. Tremendous honor to be here. Dick, you got it wrong. It is Metraxas. Dean, you got it right. No, it's Metaxas. That's a joke. Thank you.
What a friend.
Say that... I am just so humbled to be here. I've known you 30 years now. I met you 30 years ago. Dick met you 60 years ago. And the next guy who's going to speak doesn't know you at all. So, in the words of Red Buttons, this is a tougher crowd. You make it look easy. In the words of Red Buttons, I just have a question. Why are we giving this man a dinner? But I'm not going to answer that. Bruce Dumont told me strictly on the phone that I had 3 minutes. Fortunately, when he said that, I was not listening. So, because I've got 35 minutes of solid material just like this. But before I tell you how I know Dick, I just want to say, and I hate to do this to a big star, but I scripted Woody's remarks just then.
You liar.
Yeah. I met Dick, as Dick just said, in 1984 when I graduated from Yale. And I'll never forget that Harvard, for their graduation speaker, got the King of Spain. And we got Dick Cavett. And that sounds funny, I know, but oh my goodness, I'm so glad we had Dick Cavett. It's just unbelievable. And Dick spoke that day, and the only thing I remember is that he made some sort of off-color, vaguely sexist remarks that offended the pent-up, hyper-feminist undergraduates who wrote about it. And I was so glad. Thank you, Dick. It was just tremendous. Whenever anybody asks me what I want to do when I grow up, I want to have a talk show. I want to do what Dick does. And people say, well, you know, what would it be like? And there's nothing to say except, like Dick Cavett, where else do you go when you're thinking about wanting to do something like he does? There's nothing else to compare it to. I had the honor of corresponding with Dick some years ago, I guess about 14 years ago, via email. And one day the phone rang and I picked it up and it was Dick Cavett on the phone. And there's just no way to ever stop remembering what that felt like because it seemed like a joke because he sounded just like Dick Cavett, but it was like in a dream where you can fly because when you're talking to Dick Cavett, you can go in any direction and he just goes with you. It really is like flying. He's just the greatest conversationalist that's ever existed. You can talk on any subject, and it's just dreamy. It's a dreamy, dreamy thing to talk to Dick Cavett. I have, in my small way, done something. It's I think of it as an homage to Dick. I run a speaker series in New York City called Socrates in the City, and it really is modeled after what Dick does. And one day I thought, hey, wouldn't it be great to have Dick Cavett himself on as a guest? He'll never say yes, of course, but somehow he did. And I had the privilege, which was also a very scary thing, of playing the role of Dick Cavett talking to Dick Cavett. So Dean, I know what it's like. And what amazed me at that time was that, speaking of bridled humor, they weren't listening when you said bridal humor. You get to see, as you see a little bit now, that when Dick is interviewing somebody, he's tremendously witty and intelligent, we all know that, but then when you interview him, you see there's just tons of more stuff that you don't get to see when he is humbly interviewing someone else. The night I interviewed him, he quoted Robert Frost at very great length. He imitated a number of people, Jack Benny, Terry Thomas, I don't remember who else, as he's doing tonight, and he moonwalked. That's not a joke, is it? You taught Michael Jackson to moonwalk. We know that.
Yeah.
But he did. And I'm sorry?
It's easy.
It's easy?
Yeah, here's the principle. Shouldn't be exposed. It's the mime that does the walking in place, you know? But going across a stage. So when you put this foot out, like it's stepping out, your weight's on the left leg, you lower this foot, bring it, slide it, slide it, slide it, slide it back, then you shift. Then you bring this one down, slide it, slide it, slide it, and then you shift so that you get the nice moonwalk effect. And how can I? Thank you, Eric.
I am so glad that I brought that up.
Aren't you glad? Now, but the waltz is a different thing. No, but I got to tell you this. I had Eric knows this. I had the Jackson 5 on my morning show. And this little kid with Al Jolson, great performing moxie, like this, little Michael, was leading that group, and it was stunning. He just had it all. And I taught him the moonwalk. But I just want you to know that I knew Michael when he was black.
Oh. Yes. In conclusion, I just have five more points I would like to make, Bruce. No, but I do want to say that night, Dick, it wasn't just I who saw you, but everyone who was there, and it's on videotape. You can check it out at Socrates in the City. But to see you be yourself, to see you be interviewed and talk about so many different things, it was a kind of a revelation in a way, because most of us haven't had the joy of seeing that. So as wonderful as you are interviewing and speaking with people, you're even more wonderful, in my opinion, when you get to be the guest. So actually, I should probably throw it a plug. October 28th, you're going to be at Socrates in the City, and on December 3rd, I'm going to interview you about your new book, Brief Encounter at Socrates. You didn't know that, did you? At Socrates in the City. But anyway, before I sit down, I just want to say the question, Dean, you ask, what's he like behind the scenes? What's he really like? Two things I want to say. Because I've had the joy of spending a good amount of time with Dick. First of all, in some ways, he's exactly the same as he is on TV. Specifically, he always wears heavy pancake makeup wherever he goes. I don't know what that is, but he just does that. And a lot of the conversations, we were just hanging out a week ago, a lot of the conversations, even around the kitchen table and that kind of thing, all done with cue cards. I don't know why, but it's just cue cards. I don't know who does it, but just so you know.
Get off the stage,
so
you're
drunk. So he's different. He's the same as he is on TV, but he's also different You know, on TV, he's sort of affable and stuff. And in person, he can be detached, bitter, angry. And I hate to say this at a night that's supposed to celebrate him, but he can be very violent. He doesn't like to be touched. He gets very angry. You remember that night you hit Kate Smith? Oh my gosh. It's like she tapped you on the shoulder and you just turned, bang! It was like 1976 or something like that.
Oh my God.
And you know, she went down that night and people were shocked. And hitting Kate Smith, it's like punching a triceratops. It's just very... Okay, that's not true. All I want to say is that Dick is one of the most wonderful people I've ever known. The word I would use, and this is what you'd never guess, I don't think. Maybe you would. He's lovable. He's lovable. Dick, I love you. Thank you. Oh.
I need a heart transplant.
That may have been from the moonwalking.
Thank you, Eric, and for bringing up Kate Smith and my beating her up. That's wonderful. She could hardly get her moon over the mountain. Yeah, a reference for old folks.
What is your take on late night these days?
I don't watch talk shows for entertainment much. I think I had enough of it in some ways. I too get my news from Stewart, and Colbert makes me laugh. Colbert is one of the funniest people I've ever known, certainly one of the most intelligent people you will ever know, and you will see so much more of him when he does that show. That when he's decided to go on a show over time as a character, a conservative character, people said, that's the dumbest career move I ever heard of. He'll be off in 3 weeks. What is it, 7 years now? But there is the rest of Stephen when he's serious and talks. And I did a piece for Vanity Fair about him, and in talking to him about it, he said, you know, I had to get used to his not being funny all the time from seeing him only on the show. And he said, you know, there are so many times I sit there and I want to say what I really want to say, but I'm trapped in my mask. And he's so genius at coming up with something in that mask that is funny, but he'll say, there's a little frustration in that what I really feel I can't do at that time. So it'll be a treat to see the rest of Stephen Colbert. Stewart's show seems to be consistently high quality, and it's hard because I know all of what people involved in this picture, and hard to talk about all of them and not say nasty things.
It was so interesting in watching some of your old shows from you being with us on the morning news the other day and from our radio shows, and I went back and I watched how the pacing is different and how you would spend 90 minutes with one person, how talk today is so fast and quick and churned out so quickly.
Yeah. There was a meeting once, the Tonight Show, when I was, I'm not sliding off what you asked me, and the writers went to the production meeting, and people say, is Johnny in a good mood today, and you know, how's it going? And they broke down the show and talk it out, and I looked down at the rundown, it's called, and here was Peter Ustinov, great, oh God, for two short segments, then some ditzy singer, and then a cooking thing, and then some other uninteresting person. And I said, what's the philosophy of these shows? You get someone as great as Ustinov, who's pure gold, you want him to go on for 4 hours, and you say, thanks, Peter, now here's J.P. Morgan singing Ricochet Romance, or whatever. No offense, Jay, if you're here, I have bad luck on that. And they said, oh, you're crazy. The public wants change. They want, how many people watch, are enchanted by Ustinov or Orson Welles or Jonathan Miller and think, this is great, but I want a singer in 2 minutes. Bullshit. Or words to that effect.
I read.
And I said, someday I want to do a show with one guest who's good enough for the whole show.
Yeah. Did it not do well ratings-wise?
Which?
Your 90-minute shows with one guest.
Oh, no, that was always funny. ABC was always saying, get big names, and I, as we know, I did. There's a DVD out with Katharine Hepburn, Betty Davis, Orson Welles, Groucho Marx, Fred Astaire, I hate to stop like this, Frank Capra, Orson Welles and Marlon Brando and Kirk Douglas and Lucille Ball. And the whole show is there. And they all went nicely. It got better. It's easier to do 90 minutes with a great guest than to do 20 minutes with that same great guest. Because you sit there thinking, oh, so much isn't going to get in, and I wish I had more time. I never had a 90-minute show seem long. I had shows with three guests seem long, particularly Al Capp.
What happened?
I hated his guts. Well, I detested his viscera. And he disarmed me. I couldn't wait to get him on. I wanted to get him good. He had gotten me in his comic strip. And I had three women on my staff at one time, all three of whom had answered an ad, do you want to be in television? Gone up an elevator in an expensive apartment building. The doors opened into the apartment of Al Capp, wearing a loosely tied robe and nothing else. Think how lucky they were. Yeah. And he came on, and just before he came on, I had Lloyd Bucher, remember, of the Pueblo, the captain of the Pueblo? A tough, interesting, sensitive, moving interview. And this piece of dreck, Al Capp, came on from the left wings. Nobody's listening to this, I hope. And sat down, and I was reaching for my dagger, and we weren't quite on yet, because he had a missing leg, and one non-missing leg, obviously. He was a unidexter. And if anybody ever deserved it. But anyway, he sat down and he said to me cooingly, but sincerely, I don't think anybody in our business could have handled that interview with Lloyd Bucher the way you did. And I think I started to cry. And I was nice to the bastard. Oh, well. But he was a slime.
Are you hopeful for what's on television now? I read a quote where you said that we're living in an age of mediocrity. I wonder if you still think that's true with some things that are...
I don't see any signs of mediocrity waning vigorously. But, you know, I said once, startling an interviewer, television is mostly crap. So is art, so is sports, so are politics, mostly, by definition, junk. But at the top is the cream, the geniuses, the brilliant people, the good stuff. I detest people who say, I don't have a TV set. This is snobbish and stupid, because there is very, very, very great stuff you're denying yourself. You are part of it.
Nice.
In spirit, if not in... And it has to be junk, because how are you going to get good stuff to fill 1,000 channels or whatever for all those hours?
We sadly have to end our conversation.
Oh, I got another hour.
I would be happy to sit for another hour.
People afterwards often say, I wish you'd talked more about Groucho. Here's a quick thing. I have letters from him, and I treasure them, of course, and I got one out the other day, and I realized I had not read the P.S. when I first read it. I must have just glanced at it. So the letter ended, goodbye till hell freezes over, Groucho. P.S. Did you ever know that, let's see, oh, I want to be sure I get it right, because you got to get the Groucho sound. P.S. Did you ever notice that Peter O'Toole has a double phallic name?
The great Dick Cavett.
No, thank you. Thank you, sir.
The greatest.
Okay.
Thank you.
Round of applause for Dean Richards as well. Dean Richards from WGN Morning News, WGN Radio. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. One last thing for those people that participated in the raffle. In the next minute or so, you're going to see flashing across the screen tonight's winners, and we thank you very much for supporting the museum, and we look forward to seeing you next year. Thank you very much.